And thank you very much.
Thank you.
À bientôt.
Thanks, Todd.
Parfait.
That was amazing. Yeah.
Welcome and thank you for being with us today. Today we're starting the series on the YASC Lookback. YASC is the Young Adult Service Corps. And today we have a treat. We have the Director of Global Partnerships and Mission Personnel, the Reverend David Copley. Do you want to introduce yourself?
Yes, David Copley. I'm the Director of Global Partnerships and Mission Personnel for the Episcopal Church. I've been in this role and previously the mission personnel officer for around 20 years. So I've been involved in global mission for a very long time.
And who do we have with us?
And we have with us my favorite daughter, Megan Joy Copley, who was a missionary in Guatemala. And you will hear more about that as we move along.
Yeah, I don't have as many titles as my dad does anymore.
You might have more later. Can you actually, David, introduce us to the Young Adult Service Corps program?
Sure. Young Adult Service Corps is basically a program for young adults, young Episcopalians between the ages of 21 and 35 to volunteer internationally around the Anglican Communion. But that really just scratches the surface of what it really is, because it's an opportunity for Episcopalians to explore their faith through living and working alongside sisters, brothers, partners, siblings in Christ in the Anglican Communion. If you when you experience living in another culture and realize that we are all the same, that we are all children of God, brothers and sisters, siblings in Christ, that I think it elevates all of our faith into a new another level, another dynamic. And I think helps us grow as human beings, and it helps us grow as Christians.
But who can actually volunteer in the Young Adult Service Corps?
Anybody can volunteer. Anybody can volunteer and explore. I would invite anyone to explore the opportunity of being in the Young Adult Service Corps. We have a discernment and an orientation program which helps people discern whether this kind of an opportunity is right for them. Anybody can apply for the discernment program, and then it's a mutual conversation in terms of moving forward to orientation and then assignment, placement somewhere around the world. But it's not necessarily for everybody. I think that's one thing. You do have to have a little sense of independence, a sense of adventure. We do send people usually on their own, while we do have our international partners that walk alongside our young adults. You do have to have a sense of adventure and a sense of independence to really fully live into the experience.
When we mean young adult, because it's been switching around lately, what age do we mean?
So young adults between the ages of 21 and 35.
So 21, 35. So if you are in this age, or if you know somebody in this age range, please share this video with them. Your whole family is involved in mission, which is why this interview is so interesting. Before Megan joined the YASC program, when she was in her mid-20s, I believe, there was already a family involvement in church mission. Could you go over this a little bit?
Yes. Yeah, it's a fascinating, it's an interesting story in many respects, because my wife and I met in Liberia in West Africa during the Civil War. I was a lapsed Catholic at the time. we were both pediatric nurses, interestingly enough, and my wife to be at the time was a volunteer for mission for the Episcopal Church, sent by Grace Episcopal Church in New York. So we met in Liberia. We actually met at the American Embassy in Liberia, and then we kind of worked parallel with each other for a number of years. So we have lots of stories to tell as we were working mostly in rebel-held territory of the country. So it was an exciting adventure for sure. And we married, and we actually returned to Liberia for another year. So we were in Liberia for 3 years all the way through as the Civil War was happening around us. But it was interesting for me, because it was through that experience that I really renewed, had my faith renewed, and that growing sense of of being part of a larger family connected as children of God, as I kind of I've mentioned before. So it was a way for me to really grow in my understanding of my faith, but also see the faith of others being lived in times of stress and how they were still sacrificially giving to one another while at the same time living in that kind of circumstances. So we actually left Liberia when Susan was 7 months pregnant to go back to the States, which kind of connects to another story.
So you weren't born in Liberia.
So she wasn't born in Liberia.
No Liberian passport.
But you have to tell the Desmond Tutu story.
Well, I wasn't alive then, so I don't really know the story.
So
I'll tell the story. So part of one of our stories is that Desmond Tutu came to Liberia on a peacekeeping mission, and he was supposed to be meeting the rebel leaders, and all of that was canceled. So all of a sudden, his helicopter was diverted to the town where we were living, and we ended up hosting Desmond Tutu and the head of the interim government of Liberia for lunch at our little house, using plastic UN bowls, food that we could rustle up from all over the place. Susan was pregnant at the time, so Desmond Tutu actually blessed Megan while in the womb. So the history is fascinating, and I think it's having two parents who are priests is a blessing and a challenge, perhaps, in terms of that history.
And I think you took Megan on some trip as she was a child, right?
Yes. So our first placement after Megan was born, we went to Bolivia, and Megan was 5 months old. 5 months old.
Awesome.
So you don't remember.
So you remember that. You remember all of that, don't you? I'm sure you were five months old when she went to Bolivia, which was interesting in itself, because Megan really, when we were in Bolivia, we realized that everybody can connect with a family. It doesn't matter what your economic, social, linguistic background is. You see a mother and father with a five-month-old. Bolivians can connect with that. So Megan was a great evangelizer, unbeknowing to herself, in terms of just connecting with the wonderful people of Bolivia. So we were there for 4 years.
I mean, from the videos, it looks like I had a great time with the llamas.
You remember none of it?
I know stories, you know, and I think like when I'm back in Central or South America, like I pick up the smells and there's something so homey about being in that part of the world. But yeah, I just always remember the story of mom bringing me into the prisons, I think, when I was like a toddler, and us getting locked inside the prison cell. And just like... you just always had me on, you know, wherever you went, whenever you were doing mission work, you just always had me there. And I feel really fortunate to have had that experience just at such a young age, you know, because I think it made me so open-minded to people of other cultures, especially people who are probably most marginalized in society as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I should explain that prisons in Bolivia tend to be much more open in many respects. So if families would come in, mothers would often be there with their children. Susan had a very active prison ministry when she was there. So Susan would always take Megan on her back to wherever she went. What we didn't realize is when she went to visit this one person was that she was in the crime that she had committed meant that she was in a cell that had to be locked. So so when she went in for visiting hours, they went in and the cell was locked for an hour, and they were let out after the end of visiting time, which was kind of a wild experience.
Well, that's interesting. So you were in Bolivia when you were a toddler. So now we can go forward in time. In your mid-20s, you were involved in the Young Adult Service Corps. You were part of the YASC program, and you went to Guatemala. Before you tell us about this, I'd like to know, did you pick Guatemala for any reason?
I was pretty sure that I wanted to work in Central or South America. But I was pretty open as to where YASC would kind of send me. I think, like I said, you know, I felt so homey in that part of the world, and I really wanted to connect back with that, as well as develop my Spanish language speaking skills, because after I left Bolivia, I think I just stopped speaking Spanish when we moved back to the States. So I just felt like there was this connection there that I really wanted to nurture. And And so when I was told I was going to Guatemala, it just felt like such a good fit.
That's right.
Yeah, it just all felt right at the right time. And yeah, shout out to Elizabeth helping me out on that one. yeah.
What drew you to the YASC program? Is it because you had your...
Because my dad told me to do it. No, I'm just kidding.
Like, what made you decide to go do a year like this away?
Yeah, I think I've always been drawn to the adventure, you know, and being of service. You know, I did my undergraduate degree in Scotland in sustainable development. And so I was already drawn to doing outreach work, working in the community, being of service. And so after that point, I was working with young people for a period of time. But my heart just still felt like it was needing to go somewhere else, you know? And I think there was this deep longing to be of service in another part of the world and to learn and grow as a person through that experience. And so when, you know, we talk about it, and YASC was always kind of in the background because obviously my dad was working with YASC. And so I don't know, when you talk about it, I kind of could tell, like, okay, this feels like something that just fits right for me. But I was always kind of looking at Peace Corps, all these other different options. And I think, you know, YASC is just so great in that it's also really flexible in terms of looking at you as a person and what would suit you. So they're not going to kind of send you to a random place that you don't really want to go to. You know, I think the training is much more about you as a person. You know, we would get art therapy with the monks beforehand. We were doing all of this stuff to figure out kind of what's calling you. And I love that about the program, because it's not just, okay, we're going to send you off and this is where we're going to, you know, you're going to go. It's more, okay, how can we support you to be of service somewhere else? Yeah.
You're talking about orientation at Holy Cross Monastery, which is done every year before. So when you're discerning that you want to be part of the YASC program, so this is actually a long process. It's not just I apply and I go next month. It takes a long time.
Yeah, it's a long process. Shout out to Brother Rob as well. yeah, I still stay in touch with the brothers up there, you know, and I actually get spiritual direction from one of the brothers once a month now. And you know, I love that experience. And I think being connected also with the monastery through YASC is a really beautiful kind of counterpart to that program, because you're not only working on being of service somewhere else, but also your own kind of faith journey, and something that I think from YASC I've been able to nurture through my relationship with the brothers as well.
So let's go to Guatemala a little bit and your year there, because we want to know a little more about your experience. Can you tell us a little more about the people you met? Any specific story? It could be a very simple, small story, something that stays with you today or anything. Yeah. And also what you had to do when you were over there.
Yeah, I had an incredible experience in Guatemala, and it was probably one of the most transformative experiences in my life. I mean, there were definitely a lot of ups and downs. There were periods of loneliness. There were periods of adventure and excitement and fun and growth. And there was just so much. But it really, it takes you away from things that you know to make you who you are, you know. And I always remember, like, Bishop Romero was just incredible during my time there. You know, he was so much fun, and he would always like take me to different local places and want to make sure that I kind of understood Guatemala. I lived in Guatemala City for a period of time, and you know, he just tried to make it as an amazing experience as it possibly could be, you know, and really getting to know different parts of the city that maybe other people wouldn't be privy to. You know, I was living in one of the red zones, and we'd go and visit some of the red zones. And I met someone named Eddie Garcia, and he was a human rights lawyer in Guatemala, but he was also a priest as well. And so I worked really closely with him to develop a program that was... Because basically I was told you can kind of, let's see what people want. You know, I was technically a youth and social justice advisor. But we weren't exactly sure what that meant yet. You know, there was no blueprint. There weren't too many programs being done with youth. So they did have young people who were already doing kind of, they were doing youth work, but we were trying to figure out where the social justice aspect kind of fitted in, because they did a lot of really great stuff. But we were just like, how can we make this so young people are being more educated about kind of human rights, especially in Guatemala. So worked with Eddie Garcia. We got some funding from, I think it's called the World's Global Mission Fund. What's it called?
The New York Diocese Global Mission Fund.
Global Mission Funds. Mm-hmm. To start developing a Center for Human Rights Education and Outreach. So unfortunately, COVID kind of happened at the same time, but we managed to kind of work with Cristosal in El Salvador to kind of to do online programs for young people in America, young people in Guatemala, Guatemala Youth Initiative as well. You know, we developed some relationships, some really good connections. I think I wasn't the one kind of doing the work. I was more of behind the scenes, kind of putting relationships together, you know, connecting with people. And so I'd meet with the UN in Guatemala City to figure out what are they doing, to have a meeting with Guatemala Youth Initiative, figure out what they're doing, have a meeting with a church in one of the red zones, figure out what they're doing, what this young person wanted to do in one of his areas with gymnastics and community work. And sometimes it was just reviewing documents. You know, I would be reviewing this kid's like business plan that he wanted to create and kind of taking a look at it. And other times it was trying to figure out how Eddie might be able to connect with this other young person that has this other idea. So it was really kind of a behind the scenes kind of role. But I think that's one of the most important ones in terms of like the type of mission we're doing, because it's not, I was eventually going to leave.
Yeah, it's interesting because, you know, we talked about the discernment you had to do before going. Where are we going to go? Where do you want to go? What has to be done? But you also have discernment when you arrive there. Because a lot of people think that mission is, we send you to this place to build a church or to do this. Sometimes it's just we send you there and figure out what you can learn from the people and what you can also bring
there. It's not about doing for, it's doing with and walking alongside each other in the work, but also in the faith as well. Mm-hmm. And I always love, I know this is, it changes the subject a tiny little bit, but in terms of just sort of daily life, do you have a story about a chicken bus that...
I love the chicken buses.
I truly love the
chicken bus. Chicken buses are those buses that, I mean, they don't really put chickens on the top, but they're those American school buses that they would change into... I mean, they're pretty... They were pretty cool buses once they kind of do them up. But they'd have big screen TVs inside with loud reggaeton music and things hanging off the side. And you could take them anywhere.
Do you have a picture of it that I could put in after?
Yeah, absolutely.
Oh, please send me that picture. We'll put it in.
But I think I think my point was it was being part of just normal daily life. You're not living in a fancy hotel. You're living with and amongst the community.
Yeah.
And I think traveling on a local bus as opposed to taking a taxi. I think it's a small thing, but I think it's important to recognize the fact that all of our young adults really do live with and among the people that they're there.
I couldn't take buses in the city though.
No, that's true.
Well, I think now we can actually discuss something because we talked about what you learned there, what you shared also. And if we can go over like now a little bit more in the future to now, can you tell us more about what you're doing now and what you're going to do in the future and maybe how this experience, you know, reverberates with your choices today, stuff you've learned from there that still impacts you today?
The most important thing that I've learned through having the parents that I have through doing YASC is just the importance of being of service to the world, you know, and that can be in small ways, that can be in bigger ways. It can be, it's just being of service, you know, and sometimes it's sitting at, you know, waiting an hour before a meeting starts and just sitting and being there to, you know, creating business plans or looking over grant proposals to, you know, just helping someone with their suitcases down the stairs, you know? And so I think for me, it's trying to incorporate service in as many aspects of my life as I can. And so I started a doctorate in psychotherapy in the UK and it just wasn't sitting right with me. It was like, I feel very disconnected from the community. And so I came back home living with this guy. I don't think I'm ever going to move out, actually. I love being at home.
You got a sweet deal.
I have a sweet deal. And started a master's in clinical social work. So that's at the Silberman School on Is it 118th Street? So it's right in the city. But yeah, it's really more about social justice and human rights, and feels much more, it's about being of service, you know?
I really like what you're saying, because it reminds me of something that was told to me once about what is morning prayer, for example. Mm. It's making yourself available for God. Mm. And I hear what you say, and it kind of connects with me. The fact that, you know, sometimes mission is also just making yourself available to others.
Yeah.
And it's just, you know, we've talked about this before. It's about just being kind. There's no rocket science to being a Christian, you know. It's just being nice and being kind to one another. Mm. And I think that cultural sensitivity that Megan has in living in Guatemala and traveling around the world, I think for anyone, it would helps them in patience and humility and understanding, which then I think makes it easier to be more open and understanding of others and kind.
But if you don't got it, you'll learn it in YASC, that's for sure. And I think, you know, it's not going to be this perfect. I think whenever you come back from a trip, people ask you, like, was it as expected? And it's never as expected, you know? And YASC was never what it was expected. And there were a lot of twists and turns, but it all ends up in a beautiful place. And you learn so much about yourself, you know? Like, it's for anyone that kind of just is at that crossroads of not knowing kind of what's next or having questions about their faith journey, I think it's just a beautiful opportunity to grow through relationships with other people.
Yeah. Well, talking about this, actually, one of the things that actually we need to talk about is the fact that we have the application period starting in October. Mm-hmm. And since you are here and you've gone through YASC, could you maybe tell the people who might be interested, who are thinking maybe that's something I could do, but it looks scary, or I don't know. What would you tell these people?
I'm seeing Meg's on the mic. Just do it. Just try, you know. I think if you're unsure, that's okay. I think I was unsure before I started the process, and I think there were many stages of the process that I was not sure. And I feel like right now in life, I'm not sure all the time either. And that's okay. You know, it's like just trying to do the next right thing. And I think when you, with anything, if it's coming from a place of love, it's like, look at what your intentions are behind it. You know, are you running towards something, or are you trying to run away from something? And I think if you're aiming to run towards and it's coming from a place of love, it's like, just give it a shot and see what kind of unfolds, you know, like more will be revealed in that process. It's just kind of beginning the process and having a leap of faith, you know?
And, you know, it costs nothing to submit an application. There's all that orientation process after. So
yeah.
You can always change your mind or discover something new about yourself.
Mm-hmm. And I think any kind of discernment is worth it in our Christian life, in our journey. So whether you discern to do YASC or whether you discern to become a monk.
A monk, a priest, anything.
Yeah. I mean, they're pretty cool up there. I sometimes thinking cool about joining, but they don't allow women, so I might join across the street.
Well, thank you so much, Megan and David. This was a very nice discussion. I really enjoyed it. I wish we could do more of those. So please don't hesitate. We're going to put the link under this video if you want to apply. You'll learn more about YASC. And thank you.
And thank you very much.
Thank you.
À bientôt.
Thanks, Dad.
Parfait.
That was amazing, mate. Good job.